Well, good morning, everyone. How are we this morning on this bright, beautiful, sunny Sunday? My goodness me, what a lovely day it is. Lovely day. I think the Lord puts this on for us, doesn't he? Eh? Has to. Beautiful days. The flowers this morning are courtesy of Anne and Beth Coleman, and they're from her garden. My experience in the garden is mowing the lawns. And I want to really welcome you all here this morning. I want to welcome the people that are going to view the meeting this afternoon on YouTube. Welcome as well, and I hope you enjoy the meeting as well as we know that we will this morning. Now, I want to thank the band because they've just played a song called Trust and Obey. Now, it's only taken me 3 weeks to get that out of my wife's head. She can't go through all the day without saying, trust, right? So she just forgot it. Now the band of... thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah, right. Now, we've got two people in our congregation that we would like to welcome. They are originally from the UK, and they are now presiding at Scarborough. And they've decided to come along to our church this morning to see what we get up to. So we've got to be on our best behaviour, all right? And I'd like to welcome Angela and John. Now, they're in the middle there, so welcome Angela and John. And anybody that snuck in this morning without letting me know, welcome. Who?
Len Cook.
Now, where's... Oh, hello. Hello. Welcome. You're the one that snuck in.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Now, every so often we've got to really hone in on the people that are not really well that are amongst us, that they're people that have either gone to hospital, they're in hospital, they're at home, not feeling too well and what have you, and we always pray for them. It is a very, very important thing that we pray for them and bring them back to health. Let the Lord bring them back to health so that they can come and join us here on Sunday morning. Now, you would obviously see that our core officer is not here today. Ruth's not here today. And that's because he's got a very sad thing happening in his family. Keith's niece is not too well. She's in hospital. She's in a coma. And she is not, she may have to have a heart transplant. Not a good thing. And we want to pray for her. We want to make sure that we give every prayer that we can think of over to her and her family, because it must be such a traumatic time for someone that's so young to be in that situation. So it's very, very important that please offer your prayers to not only the people that amongst us, but also the family of Keith and Ruth and his brother and their wives and what have you. So it's an important thing. And of course, without Keith being here, we're honoured by the fact that we have Neil and Sharon Clanfield. They're going to be taking our meeting this morning. So welcome. What I want you to do after the meeting is I want you to go and look at our notice board. We have all these photos changing over of Queen Elizabeth. And that's going to change this afternoon. So have a look at that, and it's just a wonderful tribute to Queen Elizabeth. It really is. Sunday night meeting, that's tonight, 6 o'clock at the hall out the back. Or no, we have it in here, I think. Yeah, 6 o'clock. Now, Sam and Matt are going to take that tonight. Sam and Matt, with the help of Phil. I think Phil's coming. Yeah. So that'll be a lively night. I can tell you that right now. So if you ever heard Phil play on a Sunday night, tell you what, you can't go out without foot tapping. No way in the world. Great stuff. And of course, we know about the meal that we once a month put on before that Sunday night meeting. And the next one is Sunday the 2nd of October. So what we'd like you to do is, when... if you're wanting to come along to that meeting that we have a meal, You've got to let Lynn in the office know so that we can have numbers for catering purposes. So it's Tony, are you doing the meal again?
Yes.
Yes, Tony's doing. And of course, this coming weekend, we've got a long weekend. Monday's a holiday. And we have Band of Brothers the next day on Tuesday night. So it's important that I'll be sending an email out to all the members. And if you can get back to me whether you're attending or not, so for catering reasons, that would be greatly appreciated. Newsletter, once again, a lot of information in the newsletter. So please read that and, catch yourself up on what's going on during the week. That would be great. And this morning we have morning tea. So Angela and John, feel free to come out to that morning tea and people will make you most welcome and just have a chat and a cup of tea and a biscuit. You'd be most welcome. Thank you.
Well, thank you, John. And it's good to be here this morning. Unfortunately, under the circumstances, of course, we were down to come in a few weeks' time, but we're here today, and it's good to be in the house of the Lord and to worship God and to acknowledge why we're here. And we do appreciate the welcome and appreciate having the opportunity to come and share with you. I'd like to start the service this morning by reading a paraphrase of Psalm 145. It says, God is here. Amen. Let's celebrate. Let us enlist our lives in perpetual celebration over God's goodness and greatness. Let us announce to the world God's presence and proclaim his loving concern for all men and women. How compassionate he is over all he has created. How tender toward his failure-fraught creatures. He will not fail in any of his promises to us. His blessings are not reserved only for those who fit obediently into his design for them. He is just. He is forgiving. He gently picks up those who have fallen and restores them to sonship and servanthood. He sustains those who are wavering in weakness and grants them his grace and strength. He reaches into the void of empty lives and enriches and fulfills their hungry hearts. He is near enough to hear our every cry, to sense our every need, to grant us whatever is necessary to make us happy and productive. They're really encouraging words. This morning we're thinking about drawing near to God and the importance of us to draw near to him. But let me repeat those words that I just read. He is near enough to hear our every cry, to sense our every need, to grant us whatever is necessary to make us happy and productive as we seek to follow and serve him. How incomparably glorious is our God. May our mouths articulate and our lives demonstrate his ever-present love for all of us. God is here. Let us celebrate the eternal mercy and goodness of our God. We're going to sing a great song together and the band's going to help us. It's song number 34. It will be on the screen. It's a real song of a statement of our faith. I believe that God the Father can be seen in God the Son. These songs that were written many, many years ago are to help us as believers, as people who are seeking who God is, to really acclaim him and to proclaim our faith in him. So let us be standing and we'll sing verses 1 and 2. Thank you.
Gentleness of Jesus, love for all the world is.
Great song. Oh, sorry for that. How many verses have we got of this song?
Four
verses, right? We'll sing the next two in a moment. But I was thinking as I was singing that song, what do I really believe? What do you believe this day about God? Who he is, the relationship that you can have with him, the relationship that he wants with us. What's your belief this morning? Let's sing verses 3 and 4, thank you.
In a world of shifting values, there are standards that remain. I believe that holy living by God's grace we may attain. Oh, would he the Holy Spirit, if they listen to his voice, every Christian baby Christ-like and in liberty rejoice. All the promises of Jesus are unchanged in every way. In my yesterdays I proved them, I believe them for today. Still God gives his willing servant full equipment for the task. Power is found by those who seek him. Grace is given by those who ask.
Please remain standing for prayer. I know, sorry, I shouldn't have used my hand, should I? Let's pray. Father, we want to thank you today because of the transformation that can happen in our lives when we believe in you. And Father, we want to thank you this morning that you are God who believes in us. That Lord, you see us, you see our worth and our value. You see our significance, you see the potential in each one of us, no matter our age, no matter where we come from, where we're born, that Father, you believe in us. And Father, as a group of people this morning, we come corporately together to worship you, to acknowledge you, to state our belief in you. Lord, we come this morning to hear from your word and to learn from it. We come this morning to share with other believers and other friends. Lord, we come this morning to wait upon you. Lord, we thank you that you see us, you know our needs, and as we've sung, that Father, you're a God who is sure to his promises. And so, Father, this morning we do celebrate you. We give you thanks and we give you praise and we give you all the honour. And Lord, we commit this service to you and pray that, Lord, through it, through the singing of songs, through the hearing of your word, through the sharing with one another over morning tea, that Father, we will know that we've been with you this morning. And so we give you praise today. Lord, our thoughts are particularly with Keith's family, with his niece in particular. And Father, this morning as she lays there in hospital, Lord, we ask that your healing hand would be upon her. That Lord, you would bring restoration to her body. Lord, we pray for the doctors and for the nurses, for those who attend to her, that, Father, we thank you for them, but, Father, you would give them wisdom and guidance in these days. And, Lord, for all of the family, the extended family who undoubtedly are concerned and worried, who undoubtedly have many emotions that they're experiencing at this time, Lord, we pray that your presence would be with them, that your peace would be with them, that there would be an assurance in their heart that not only are people praying for them, but you're a God whom they can reach out to at this time. And so, Lord, we bring these things to you now and pray this through the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And amen. Please be seated. Going to have the offering, and I think someone's going to lead us in the offering this morning. Is that right? And we'll be waited upon for your offering, and we'll have a prayer after. Thank you.
Almighty God, you are here with us as your people. May we remain ever faithful to our Lord Jesus Christ, who died on Calvary for us, to bring us salvation, a full salvation, and a hope in the world today. So, Father, the offering we bring today is given in your name. Bless the offering. Use your people here. May Christ be glorified. Amen. Amen.
The Bible reading this morning is taken from James chapter 4, reading verses 1 through the 10. And be reading from the New Living Translation. Actually, going through James in personal devotions at the moment, have been for a couple of weeks now, and it's a very practical letter, a very challenging letter in many ways, but a letter which I believe that when we read it and take time to reflect on it, can say a lot to us. And I would encourage you to in your own personal devotions, in your personal time, to take time to read through the book of James. If you haven't done it ever, I would encourage you to do so, to try it. It's a great book. But if you've read it many, many times, do it again and ask God for fresh revelation. But this chapter here, chapter 4, it's under the heading of Drawing Close to God, which is what we're thinking about today. Chapter 4, verses 1 through to 10. What is causing the quarrels and fights among you? Don't they come from the evil desires at war within you? You want what you don't have, so you scheme and kill to get it. You're jealous of what others have, but you can't get it. So you fight and wage war to take it away from them. Yet you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it. And even when you ask, you don't get it because your motives are all wrong. You want only what will give you pleasure. You adulterers, don't you realize what friendship with the world makes, that friendship with the world makes you an enemy of God? I say it again. If you want to be a friend of the world, you make yourself an enemy of God. What do you think the scriptures mean when they say that the Spirit of God has placed within us, is filled, that the scriptures, I'll start again, verse 5, what do you think the scriptures mean when they say that the Spirit of God has placed within us is filled with envy? But he gives us even more grace to stand against such evil desires. As the scriptures say, God opposes the proud, but favours the humble. So humble yourselves before God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come close to God, and he will come close to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, purify your hearts, for your loyalty is divided between God and the world. Let there be tears for what you have done. Let there be sorrow and deep grief. Let there be sadness instead of laughter and gloom instead of joy. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up in honour. Interesting reading, isn't it? And I believe that God would want to speak to all of us this morning in regard to how he wants us to not only be hearers of the word, but doers of the word. I'm going to sing another song together, song number 613. It will be on the screen again. And again, it's a song like the song we sang earlier, a statement of what we are going to do. We've talked about what we're going to believe, but here it says, what are we going to promise to do? It's a great old song, and I believe it's an encouraging song, and let's sing verses 1 and 2. Thank you.
Oh, Jesus, I have promised to serve thee to the end. Be thou forever near me, my master and my friend. I shall not fear the battle.
Go back to that last verse for a moment. I'm not sure when the writer wrote this song, but very much for me, as I looked at these words and thought about them, the words that were just talked about, the echoing of James chapter 4, and this prayer that we would come close to God, that we would draw near to him. But there are other things which can draw us away from that, and it's a great song and a good song to reflect upon. Let's sing verse 3. Thank you.
Oh, let me hear thee speaking in accents clear and still above the storms of passion, the murmurs of self-will. Oh, speak to reassure me, to hasten or control. To make me listen, thou guardian of the soul.
We're going to sing verse 4, and the piano is going to help us as the band join the congregation.
Thus thou hast promised
to
all who follow thee. Thou art in glory, how shall thy servant be? And Jesus,
are you going to pray? You're going to pray?
Yeah. To serve thee to the end, oh, give me grace to follow.
No.
Let's pray together. Father God, we pause to acknowledge that there is none other like you. You are the God of all creation, the God who formed the heavens and the earth, the God who breathed life into mankind. And we are privileged as your people to be given such a day where we can corporately come to worship you. And so in so doing, Lord, we pray that as we do seek you today, and as we draw close, may we experience the abundance of your presence with us. And so, Lord, we pray, open our eyes to see you, our ears to hear you, and our heart to respond to you. And we ask and invite you to have your way in us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, it's really good to be here, and not because of the circumstances. We're very mindful of what's going on for Ruth and Keith and their family. But it is good to also be here this morning and to spend time in worship together, and it was enjoyable. So thank you to the band and for just the sense of God here. Now, John drew our attention to the bulletin board and the pictures of the Queen, and I must admit, I was drawn to wanting to see the whole reel through. It has been quite spectacular. Did anyone watch the funeral or even leading up to? Got a few. Oh, some didn't. Some. Look, I must admit that I was pretty glued to the TV and watching every moment I could, and just to see the majestic, the awesome, or the people, the crowds, and it's unbelievable to think that people came from everywhere to be there. People travelled overseas to be there. And people were prepared to wait 16 hours in a queue that was 8 kilometres long to walk past for what a moment, a brief moment. It was unbelievable that they were prepared to, you know, stay in the cold, in the rain, it rained, and be uncomfortable for a moment in time. And to be honest, maybe I would have been one of those people if I was over there to get a glimpse of either the casket going past or to be able to walk via the casket that lay in state in Westminster Hall. It was amazing. You couldn't help. The world stopped at this moment. So what is it that causes people to have this intense need to go through uncomfortable weather and circumstances just for that moment? And as I thought about that, I thought, what a message for the church. What a message for us, that these people are prepared to watch a casket go past and pay their respects as I believe they should. And yet, sometimes we don't always want to come out to church or spend time with God. Is it the same urgency? Do we have the same intensity in this desire to come close to God? And here in this passage that James, in his letter, he's writing about drawing close to God. And as we look at these people who went through the circumstances they did to get a prominent place, just to see for a moment an event in history, and then, you know, look at our lives as believers and see whether or not we would go to those same extents. And here's James saying, to come near to a God who is living and alive, and not only a God who we can see, but will encounter when we draw near to him. So come near to God. Another, I guess, interesting thing about this was that for these people to draw near, they had to leave something. So for some of them, it was their homes. Some of them, it was their comfort. And the same applies for us as believers. For us to draw near, we have to leave something. And in this letter, James refers very much to what has to be left to draw near to something. And he goes on, and as Neil encouraged us, go and look at the book of James again and be challenged by how relevant it is for us as believers. I might add that this letter was not to unbelievers. This letter is to believers. And I look out at a congregation that have been on this journey for a long time, many years, and yet this still applies for us today. As we drove here today, and we had a little bit of time up our sleeve, and we were really enjoying the surroundings, and we drove along the front of the waterfront. But I love trees, and I love it. My favourite thing about trees is when it comes like over a road, and I was looking at some of the trees beside the road, and some of them almost look like bonsai, you know, big bonsais, in how they're shaped. And I thought, these trees are really quite old. But these trees needed to be pruned back constantly for them to hold their shape but not interfere with the lines that were overhead. And that is so relevant for us also as believers, that no matter how long we've been on this journey, the pruning back and the refining continually needs to happen. And this is what was being written about for the believers that James was referring to. Now, it's interesting also that for the people who wanted to view the casket or get in line to see the Queen, there were barriers. They could only go so far. And there were barriers that would, you know, keep them from going any further. And this is so true for us also. There are barriers that sometimes are there that keeps us from where we need to be. And unlike the people in UK who didn't put these barriers up, these Christians erected their own barriers. These were self-formed barriers that were in place that prevented them from moving closer to God. And so I want to unpack a little bit of that before we actually look at the part of the steps that need to be taken to move into God. So firstly, in verse 1, It says, what is causing the quarrels and fights among you? Don't they come from the evil desires at war within you? And so the first barrier is this external thing of fighting and quarrelling. Now, this word quarrelling refers to fights that are not with weapons. These are personal conflicts. These conflicts have nothing to do with the outside world. These quarrels are within the church, among believers. And so immediately James names it. But he says he doesn't point fingers here. He identifies where they're coming from. And he says they come from within you. What's going on within you? Often when we have disagreements or we're quarrelling, we're upset, or there's arguments that occur, or there's disunity within the body, we're looking at the other person. And James says, look at yourselves. Look within. What is God showing you, revealing to you within? So he makes it incredibly clear where the problem lies. He says the problem comes from their own evil desires at war within them. He was saying, the sin is within you. Start checking yourselves. Stop looking at others and finding their faults, and look at yourselves and what's going on in your life. And then he says in verse 2, he talks about you want what you can't have. So you want what you don't have, so you scheme and kill to get it. You are jealous of those and others around, but you can't get it, so you fight and you're at war. You don't have because you don't ask. And so here again, he says, ask me. Ask me. And I know that sometimes that verse can be taken out of context. And we think, I want something. And the Bible says, ask and it will be given. But what James is referring to here is not the wants and the me and what I want in that regards, but he's saying, all you need is me. All you need is me. I am enough. And so he's saying, ask me to fill your life. Ask me to give you your life's contentment and the blessings that I've got. Instead of them quarrelling, looking at external things or people, he's saying you don't have what you want because you're not asking. And you're not asking me. And I'm not enough. I believe that's so challenging. That often we look for external things to satisfy our greatest needs. And yet God is saying, here I am. All you need is me. I'm enough. You don't have what you want because you're not asking me for it. You're not asking. So God is enough. And then he says, check your motives when you do ask. Verse 3, and even when you ask, you don't get it because your motive is all wrong. You want only what will give you pleasure. So we pray for self. We pray about our own schemes and things that we want. And it becomes self-absorbed. And then he goes on to say, it's not just ask, you know, you may be asking for what is all right, so your prayers might be fine, but it's how you're asking. And it's behind, the motive behind what you're asking for. So some of the commentaries I looked at, and someone, one of them I read, it says, even if you pray for good things, yet you do not pray well or in the right manner, not according to God's will. And you pray for things that are external or things that are going to satisfy what you want, or you want things to go to a certain way. And God is saying, watch, check your motives when you pray. When you come before me, check those. And then James goes on to give them some steps to drawing close to God. Firstly, he says, humble yourself before God. So when we need to submit, to let go of our will, our desires, our purpose, the things that we want, and to humble ourselves before God. And it's in laying down ourselves, our thing, our agendas, to seek God, to humble ourselves before him. One of the things I loved about watching the Queen Elizabeth II's funeral was how people, as a casket went past, or as they walked past her in Westminster Hall, they bowed their heads. It's quite powerful, isn't it, all curtsied, in respect for her position and her royalty, but also the life that she gave for 70 years. And so they bowed their heads as the casket went past, or they threw flowers out in honouring her. And it was quite spectacular, wasn't it, to see these flowers fly or land on the car. And in saying that, how much more should we bow to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords in honouring God above all else, above everything, to honour God? How much more is God deserving for his people to say, not my will, I humble myself, all I am, I give to you. And then he goes on to say, resist the devil. And often it's this warring against what the world would say hold on to, which is, can be my rights and my, you know, me. And he's saying, resist that. Resist the devil. And he will flee from you. And in this passage, it's this whole warring against the world owning, or sin owning, or God owning our lives. What our thoughts are, what our words are, what our attitudes are. God owning, resist those things that would bring a barrier and get in the way and give ourselves completely to God. And then we read, come near to God. And as I said earlier, to come near is to leave something behind. To come near something is to leave something. And so it's to move away from anything that will get in the way of that intimate relationship with God. Anything that would distract us from our focus being on God. And it's moving in and positioning ourselves in a place to know God and his will and his purpose for our lives. Often, it's not those loud external things that are the hindrance, but it's the inner things of pride and a critical spirit and words that hurt and damage, hatreds, unforgiveness, the inner sins of desires that become the barrier that hold us back from drawing close to God, to know God and to experience the abundance of all he has for us. So to come close is to be intentional about what I leave and what I'm drawing close to. What do I need to leave to come close to the living God? And then it goes on to say, wash your hands, purify your heart. Don't have divided heart by saying one thing yet doing another. And James is all about that. James is all about this, can fresh water flow from the same spring as salt? You know, so many different illustrations of this division that can happen within a person's well-being and life. And he says in chapter 3, sometimes it praises our Lord and talking about the tongue and Father, and sometimes it curses those who have been made in the image of God. So this divide of one breath praising God, the next breath cursing man who have been made in the image of God. And so he says, come close to me wholeheartedly and have a change of heart in the process. The only way we can do that is to let God change and wash our hands, purify our heart, so that we can draw close to the living God. And finally, when we do this, James says, God will come close to us. Come close to God, and he will come close to us. Let's pray. Father God, there's so many things that can get in the way of that intimate relationship you so want us to have in you. And Lord, whether we're new to the journey or many, many years down the track, there are still things, Lord, that can keep hold of us, that prevent us from fully embracing all that you have for us as your people. And so today, make us mindful of the things that we've allowed to take root that are a hindrance to us knowing you more intimately. And Lord, do a work in us that we would have hearts fully yielded to you, that we would bow our head, our will to you, and that we will have that same urgency to be close to you as we witnessed in these last days of the people drawing close to a casket. Lord God, do your work continually in us. We want to see a new move of your Holy Spirit. Help us to love each other. Help us to embrace all that you have for us as your people, that the world will see the intimacy of your love in and expressed through us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I don't know if you can sort of reflect on that word without being really challenged. And as I was listening to the words and thinking about how it applies to my life, how close am I to God, asking that question, sense, am I drawing near to him? What are the barriers in my life? What are the walls that I'm putting up? Is there any relationship that's not quite right that I need to be working on? It's certainly a challenging word. And a word that God wants to not come down heavy on us today, but it's a word delivered with grace. It's a word that God says to us, that my grace is sufficient, and I'm here to help you through that. I'm close, but I need you to draw close to me also. And I had this sense, this sort of picture, as Sharon was speaking, that, you know, wherever we are in the day, wherever we're walking and even sitting here, God is here. God's presence is here with us. And he's just waiting. He's just waiting for us to draw close to him. And even when we put ourselves a long way away, that he's still there, but he just waits for us to draw close to him, to experience his presence in our lives, to experience his peace and his grace, his forgiving spirit. It's a good word that comes to us. Challenging word, yes, but an important word for us today, especially as believers. We've got just a few moments, we're going to end the meeting in just a moment, but there's a beautiful song in our songbook. It's been added, and it's a little bit old now, but it really fits with what we're thinking about today. And if we go to the chorus for a moment, thanks. And it talks about this sense of giving ourselves to God, of drawing close to him, of allowing him to take us, and just as a potter takes the clay and molds it, to allow God to do that. So we're going to sing the chorus through, and time of reflection. If it is this morning, that would be helpful for having someone to pray with you. Not sure quite what happens here, but you're certainly welcome to come to the front, and you can stand or kneel. If it is that you just want to make a personal commitment, of course we don't need to physically do that, but if it would help you today, then we would love to pray with you. So let's sing this song together. Thank you. Lord, wonderful Saviour, I know for sure all of my days are held in your hand, crafted into your perfect. Gently call me into your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me, dear Lord, to live all of my life through your eyes. I'm captured by as we go through that song again, let's just be quiet. We won't sing it, but allow the words to speak to you, allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you through the words. Make it your prayer today, and as we take this time to just come to a conclusion, let's reflect on what these words and what the word has said to us today. Thank you. Father, we want to thank you for this time we've been able to share this morning together. We want to thank you for this amazing day that you've given to us. Thank you for life. We thank you for the blessings that you pour out upon us day after day. And Lord, even in the tough times, the challenging times, we thank that you are God, who, as the word says, never leaves us, never forsakes us, but is always there. And so, Father, this morning, as we've been challenged and as we've been caused to reflect on what it means to draw close to you, that, Father, we will live this week in that posture of drawing close to you. Lord, help us to deal with those things in our lives that need to be dealt with. Help us to walk in grace, to walk in your love, and to be the people of God that you've called us to be. Lord, we give to you the rest of this day and as we go into this week. Lord, may we know your presence in a way that maybe we've never experienced it before. Your presence within us, around us, surrounding us. And Lord, we pray all these things in and through the strong name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Well, it's been good to worship with you today, and we do pray that this week will be a good one for you. And please join us for some refreshments in the back hall, I take it. I'd love to be able to have a chat and to catch up in that way. But this morning for the benediction, I pray that the great love of God would help us to be more loving, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ would help us to be more gracious, and the power of the Holy Spirit would empower us to be the people that he's called us to be. May God be with you each. God bless you. Thank you.